It's one of the strangest landmarks on the south coast. Today, it's a skeleton remnant from a lost age of grandeur crumbling into the sea, Brighton's West Pier. But once it was a splendid piece of Victoriana. The West Pier has stood for over 150 years. Today, a reconstruction of the toll booths are all that remains of the original entrance of the West Pier. But we're going to look at the pier's colourful history, at how it survived two world wars, two great storms, and two devastating fires. And yet, after all that, she remains an icon of the South Coast. The performers on the West Pier provided the perfect subject for the pioneers of British cinema who were working in Brighton at the time.
In terms of the history of film in Brighton, the West Pier has a very special place. Professor Reddish was one of the many professors who performed at the West Pier, because you can imagine when the West Pier extended itself, it not only had a theatre at the end, but also to this area for diving and fishing and for boats to land. Professor Reddish was there to perform, and what a performance it was, not only with his bicycle, but also literally diving from a height into the sea.
The pier was originally designed for people to promenade, or as the architect Eugenius Birch put it, to walk on water.
It was founded on this amazing engineering that came out of the Industrial Revolution. Its engineer, its architect, because of course there was no separation at the time, was Eugenius Birch.
One of those great Victorian engineers, you know, along with Brunel and co. He invented a way of screwing a pile into the seabed, and so began this almost epidemic of piers around the coastline. And the West Pier wasn't actually the first of Birch's piers, but it was in the first wave of those piers. It was undeniably the most beautiful pier that he ever constructed.
The West Pier went from strength to strength in the early 1900s. It reached its heyday in the 1920s and 1930s, when Brighton was buzzing.
Well, I suppose I was round about 10, something like that, middle to late 1920s. And I think it cost about sixpence, something like that. This is old pence, of course. Whenever I had the opportunity, I had to get onto the pier. It was a completely different feeling. You left the land, you left the town, and you were somehow in a completely different world, in a kind of cocoon of your own. Beyond the theatre was the entertainment area with every kind of a machine.
I think there's something sort of quintessentially British about piers. I think it latches into all our childhoods and our parents and our grandparents. They're sort of just traditionally British and people just love them.
You can't grow up in Brighton without feeling something for the piers. And my very first job was on the West Pier as manager of the rifle range, which was sort of slung under the pier. And then I graduated to bingo calling in the Pier Pavilion, which had been the original theatre. As the whole issue of the seaside holidays started to take off and trying to attract people onto the pier, you had to begin to do more in the way of entertainment. The West Pier was a really quite a sophisticated place. So you would have a season of Bernard Shaw's plays, you'd have seasons of Shakespeare, and they'd be doing eight different plays in the week, you know, with the two matinees. You'd have seasons of touring operas. They were wonderfully classless structures. So people would certainly wear their finery to go on the pier, but it would be classless. They were sort of a republic of fun, if you like. And once you passed through the turnstiles, you were into this fantasy land, into another world. All the rules of society were sort of dissolved once you walked onto the pier. It was very fashionable to be unwell, to parade your ailments. The pier was supposed to be a healthy place, you know.
The West Pier became a stage and film set. It was graced by some of the country's leading stars.
What's astonishing about the film was that all of it was shot in Brighton, and all the key scenes were shot on the West Pier.
Goodbye, goodbye, wipe the tear, baby dear, from your eye. Though it's hard to part, I know. I'll be tickled to death to go to cry.
There were so many films which were shot on the West Pier, and indeed in Brighton, across the 1960s. West Pier provided a really useful location for so many films. And of course, Oh What a Lovely War, it's not just a location, it actually is the site for almost the whole film.
Of course, there was a dark underside to the pier, just as there is a dark underside to Brighton, and that's provided many a crime writer with inspiration.
I've swum underneath them, and I've been in boats on it, and you look up these great rusted girders, and you know, the sheer stuff you see floating past them. I remember as a kid, I used to watch these jellyfish, constant stream of them. I saw a jellyfish the size of a tractor tire once, and I thought, do I want to swim around the pier? So many great places to hide a body around the pier. There's always a joke that if you want to get rid of a body, you know, set it in the struts of some big structure. So when I look at the piers, I do often wonder, when they built those piers, has anybody maybe cemented inside them?
But the real crime took place in 2003 when the West Pier burnt down.
Well, strangely, the first fire was by far the most dramatic. That was a Friday, and huge blaze. It was in the Pavilion building, which is, well, what is the ruin that you see now, furthest from the beach. So the fire services could do nothing, impossible for them to get to it. So we just stood on the beach watching it burn down. It was a horrible, horrible thing to witness. The second fire, which actually was the death knell, was rather less dramatic. I don't think it was as windy. So it took much longer to destroy the concert hall. Really a couple of days. But of course that was actually the thing, that was the fire that ended the story. A terrible, terrible act of vandalism. We lost our lottery funding and we had no pier. And there was going to be no chance of major funding after losing the lottery funding. We had nothing left, really, but we thought the board decided they'd have one last attempt of making something of the site. And we were sort of deliberating that and putting together a prospectus when we were, so far as we were concerned, approached out of the blue by David Marks.
Our concept for the I-360 was very much a phoenix type of project for the West Pier. It's not exactly the same thing, but it's the same thing turned through 90 degrees. It's taking the horizontal pier and lifting it up like that.
For Paddle Around the Pier 2018. It's another glorious weekend in Brighton and Hove. And the main event today, of course, paddle something unusual around the pier and the paddle, as well as all the usual fun and games.
So I'm responsible for the water sports section of the event.
Okay, so break that down. So this is like all the major events, like the paddle something unusual, and it looks like chaos. We've been down there today. So on a day-to-day basis, what is your role? Is it just sort of controlling people and making sure no one drowns, that kind of thing?
Basically, it's a case of getting all the craft down by 7 o'clock in the morning. Obviously, they weren't down because we all had hangovers from the football, so we're staggering in to about 11:30. We had about 40 craft register, and in the case of they build the craft on the beach, a lot of them do, and then we have to be very organised, line them up and just get them in the water safely, of course.
I'm joined now by Robert Nemeth and Chief Brodie of Jaws fame. You're looking quite confident. Any sort of early sightings of sharks?
Not really, because the Mayor Vaughan's keeping the beaches open today, and I think the beaches should be closed. So we're going to be out there looking for some sharks and putting buoys on them.
I'm joined now by Princess Peach and the Mario Brothers. What a gang, what a team. How are you feeling?
Quite confident now. Yes, wow. It's been a long journey to get here, but we're doing really well, I think.
Tell us a bit about your vessel and how this has come about. What's been the inspiration?
Well, we are on a Game Boy, because that's where we came. We climbed out of the hole in the middle, and then we're going to ride it into the sea. It's going to be beautiful.
Are you riding for any particular charity, or is it just for fun?
We are riding Rocking Horse, the charity for the Trevor Mann unit,
Trevor Mann baby.
For the hospital up the road.
Okay, there's the voice. Okay. I mean, because when I first came, probably 10, 12 years ago, it was just sort of water sports, but it has now turned into sort of a water sports come music festival now, hasn't it?
Music festival, come food, come family. I mean, the fact is that we just want it to get bigger and better. And you can't just have it for water sports, and we try to keep it very focused towards water sports. And water safety as well is a big thing. Water cleanliness, the environment, we're trying to move away from using plastic and going more veg-ware. So paddle has to change, it has to develop, it has to get better, it has to get bigger, hopefully. And allows us to just take a little bit more money from the public to do so much good for charities in Brighton and Hove and the local region. That's what we're really about.
Everybody loves to go up high. It's almost an innate human desire to get up high and enjoy the view, to see the landscape stretched out beneath you like a carpet. It's a beautiful sight.
There's nothing of this height that is this thin, and it is that feature which really drives the design.
We've sort of got the band back together, really, who did the London Eye. We've got a fantastic team of very, very skilled engineers and contractors all coming together to make something that's never been done before. Absolutely thrilled. It's been 10 years in the making, and finally we've got something very tangible to show for it.
I think that we will see an ongoing increase in tourism, and the I360 coming to Brighton has only got to be good news.
You're just starting to get a sense of what the height will be. If you can imagine all these cans that we can see here laid up all together going up into the sky, it's going to be an incredible sight when it's finished.
I'm from this area, and I think that the I360 will be fantastic.
I think it's a wonderful landmark. I think something good for Brighton, really.
The fluidity of the glass. You can look at the renders and the drawings, but not until you see it in reality do you realize how amazing it really is.
What we're doing is we're reconstructing two new toll booths, and they'll be sitting at the same location as the previous toll booths.
Connections with Brighton and with Sussex. Obviously, just up the road at Gatwick, we're flying 67 destinations around the world. So many of our staff live in this area, so many of our customers come from this area. It's just a really natural fit.
incredible experience. Really.
It's great to see Brighton from a different angle.
It's a fantastic day. I can't tell you how lucky we feel.
Award-winning crime writer Peter James has released his new novel from the successful Roy Grace series. His book launch took place at the British Airways i360, and Latest TV talked to him about his newest release, Need You Dead.
Need You Dead is it's kind of the first whodunit that I've ever written with the Roy Grace. It starts off with a woman who's works at home. She's a hairdresser. She's in an abusive relationship. She's having an affair for the past 18 months with a guy who's been promising her he's going to leave his wife, take her off to a safe place and start a new life with her. And she realizes this guy has told her a false name. Everything he's told is a lie. And she decides she's going to get even with him big time. This novel actually is probably more Brighton than some of my last ones. Love You Dead, the previous one, was partly set in New York and France and India.
The book's lead female character ends up in conflict with a male suspect due to his bank account being hacked. And Peter spoke of how the recent spate of cybercrimes across the globe inspired his plot.
I've written that whole thing to highlight just how much cybercrime is going on right now. And it's like the huge amounts we've been hearing in the news this past week about the NHS. Very often it is relatively small amounts of money, almost too small in many cases for the police to be able to cope with or bother with, and it's hurting people very badly, and I wanted to write about it and highlight it.
I'm a massive fan. I've known Peter now for 30 years. I've even designed some of his books, and I've read everything he's written over those years, including the children's books. I'm a big fan, and they're great. They're a great read. I love the fact that one comes out at this time of the year, so I can take it on holiday with me.
It's funny we should be in the i360 at the moment, because the whole climax of the novel takes place at the i360. I think it's probably the first time it's been used in fiction.
I am a big fan, yeah. I was a little bit nervous to begin with for the Roy James series because I'm a bit of a wuss and I was scared of all the crime scenes around Brighton. But no, I'm eagerly anticipating the next book. I can't wait. I'm going to head over and get it shortly.
We live just down the road from Peter, yeah.
We're very fortunate to see them socially occasionally as well, so yeah.
See how his mind works, really.
So I think he has got the crime genre absolutely right. He knows how to put together a good plot and keep you thinking right up till the end, and that's what makes a great crime novel.
The Sussex Police are fantastic to me in terms of giving me help, but in a way, Brighton has got such a crime pedigree. You know, there's always this constant change going on in the city.
Inspired by ideas from real-life crime, Peter has written international bestsellers. And with 13 Roy Grace books out, we asked if Roy will ever retire.
Roy's never going to retire. He loves his job too much. And luckily, he's only 41 at the moment, so he's got a fair amount of time left.
This is Nelda Pereira for Latest TV News.
Fatboy Slim performed a two-hour set to a sellout crowd on the i360 last night. To a backdrop of the stunning sunset over his adopted hometown, Fatboy Slim, otherwise known as Norman Cook, played to 120 lucky revelers and to hundreds of thousands of viewers on the Facebook livestream, set up by the French company Circle, who organised the event. Fatboy told Latest TV he would have been disappointed not to have been the first DJ to perform in the pod, after several previous failed attempts, including the launch of the i360 in August 2016. Fatboy exclusively revealed to Latest TV that having played most of the clubs in the city, the beach several times, the MX and now the I-360, he has set his sights on a show at the Madeira Terraces, where they are hopefully fully restored in the future.
Goodbye.